Dear students, hello and assalamu alaikum. I am Ali Abbas Qazilbash and I have with me Darakshan Islam who will help us in the presentation of this program. Today we shall discuss that branch of biology that deals with the study of plants called botany. As you may be aware, the study of plants is a vast area, but in this particular program we shall concentrate mainly on the external features of flowering plants. This program will deal basically with the knowledge that will give you the simple idea of how to identify plants. Now, the first aspect of studying anything is the ability to recognize it based upon its external features. The study of external features of any living organism is called morphology. Morphology, the study of the external features of living organisms, is essential for its identification and characterization into specific groups and subgroups. As you also may be aware, the branch of biology which deals with the identification, naming, and classification of organisms to put them in a specific group or subgroup is called taxonomy.
Although the taxonomy of plant involves a detailed study of various parts of plants, as well as the environment in which they live, but our program will comprehensively highlight the particular parts of plants in general, and flowers in particular. Now, generally speaking, different parts of plants are, as you can see in this one, roots, shoot or stem, branches, its leaves, this flower, and the fruit, which is formed inside the flower. So, these were the basic or the main part of a plant. Now, basically, classification of different plants is based on certain characters. Now, in order to classify any plant, we have to study these all characters one by one in detail so that we can place them in a specific group or subgroup. Classification of anything, living or non-living, is basically its arrangement or positioning within a group or subgroup on the basis of similarities of that thing with the other members of the same group. Now, this basic character of classification helps us to identify different plants or animals easily and to study their natural interrelationships. Now, there are certain plants which are also classified on the basis of the environment in which they live. And on the basis of these environmental classification, different groups of plants could be, for example, desert plants, land plants, water plants, or mountain plants.
Now, to start off with, we shall first discuss the root system of plants. You should be aware of the fact that a seed germinates into a seedling, which then develops into a complete plant. And the roots are known as the descending portion of a plant. The root, which develops from the radical of the seed, helps in the absorption of water, dissolved salts, and minerals from the soil. There are basically two types of root systems, the taproot system and the fibrous root system. In the taproot system, the primary root descends downwards into the ground and forms the main root, such as that of the mango and rose. In the fibrous root system, on the other hand, there is no main root, and instead you have long, thin fibers that are in equal length and develop straight from the base of the stem, such as that of the onion and grass, here well illustrated, as these are called fibrous roots or adventitious roots. This is of the onion, and this here is of the grass, which are clearly seen as fibrous roots. Adventitious roots are those roots that do not develop from the radical. Instead, they grow from any other part of the plant. For example, the roots of the bunion tree, the prop roots of the bunion tree, and the aerial roots of the mangroves.
Now, the next part of the plant which we shall discuss is the stem of the plant, or you can say the shoot of the plant. This is also normally called the aerial part of the plant. There are some stems which do not grow above the ground, rather they grow under the ground. And this is the reason why they are called underground stem. For example, that of potato, and as you can see, that of onion. Now, stem basically bears different types of parts, which includes branches, leaves, fruits, flowers, nodes, and internodes. Now, let's first of all define what is node. Node is basically that part of the stem through which different types of leaves or one or more than two or more than two leaves arise. This is what you call a node. Now, what is an internode? Internode is that part of the stem which lies between two adjacent nodes. So these are some specific characters which are present on the stem, or you can say shoot of any plant.
After discussing the stem of a plant, we shall now look at the leaves of a plant and their arrangement on the stem or branch. The science of the arrangement of leaves on a stem or branch is known as phylotaxy and is essential to properly taxonomically characterize a plant. Phylotaxy is the study of the way in which leaves are arranged on a stem or branch. Basically, a leaf can be simple or compound, and here illustrated is a simple leaf. Now, the simple leaf consists of a blade or lamina, a flattened portion of it, and within it is the midrib, and from the midrib arise veins and veinlets. A compound leaf, on the other hand, has more than one leaf in it, and therefore has more than one leaf blade. And there are basically two types of compound leaves, pinnate and palmate. Now, it's essential to know what a leaflet is. If a leaf arises from the midrib or any other branch of a leaf or stem, it is known as a leaflet. Now, in the pinnate compound leaf, the leaflets arise from different parts of the stem or branch. Whereas in a palmate leaf, the leaves arise from a single point, as do our fingers from the palm of our hands. And the examples of these, of a pinnate leaf would be a rose, and that of a palmate leaf would be silk cotton.
So far, we have discussed about root, stems, leaves of the plant. So now our next topic of discussion is inflorescence, which is basically the flowering system of a plant or arrangement of flowers on a branch of a plant. Now, this inflorescence basically helps us to characterize the plants into further group or any subgroup. And this specific character is considered by many as the main or the most important character to place any plant in a specific group or subgroup. Now, sir, would you please further explain about inflorescence?
Yes, most definitely. As you've heard, students, inflorescence is the mode of arrangement of flowers on a branch or stem. We will, however, just outline a few of the important kinds of inflorescence. Inflorescence may be classified into two types. One, the racemose or indefinite inflorescence, and secondly, cymose or definite inflorescence. In racemose inflorescence, the main axis or shoot continues to grow indefinitely, producing flowers laterally. The lower, older flowers open before the younger, upper flowers. And a good example of that is the mustard flower. Racemose inflorescence is then further divided into seven different classes based upon the specific arrangement of flowers on a plant. And they are raceme, spike, spadix, catkin, corm, umbel, and capitulum. In cymose inflorescence, however, the main axis ceases to grow, ending in a terminal flower. In this inflorescence, the lower flowers are younger than the terminal flowers. An example of that is, of course, jasmine. The common type of cymose inflorescence are two types, basically uniparous or monocasial cymose, which is then further divided into helicoid and scoropoid cymose. And the other type is biparous or dicasial cymose.
Now, let's discuss the most important character of a plant on which the classification of most of the plants is based, meaning how to classify them in group or further groups. So this character is basically the structure of flowers. Flowers are highly modified shoots specially adapted for the purpose of reproduction. The main function of a flower is to propagate individual plants by producing seeds in order to maintain the continuity of a species. Flower even has further subparts which are very important and which should be considered as such. Now, a flower can have different important parts as, number one, thalamus. Thalamus is basically a short flattened axis, or you can say a short flattened floral axis, on which the four whorls of the floral parts are arranged. As you can see this flower, the four important parts of these flower could be, number one, as you can see, this is the stalk. These are the bracts. And further, these are the sepals. These are petals. These are the stamens. This is the female reproductive part, which is called carpel. So meaning this is how you can easily identify a flower into four basic or important parts. Now, in order to differentiate between a stalk and a thalamus, let's discuss another thing which is called pedicel. Now pedicel, as you can see here, this part, which is a stalk of a flower, this is what you call a pedicel. So this is the difference between a thalamus and a pedicel. And a flower which is having a pedicel, this is what you call pedicellate flower, and a flower which do not have any pedicel or stalk, this is what you call a sessile flower. Now sir, would you please explain how can you differentiate exactly between a thalamus and a pedicel?
Yes, that's not a problem. The thalamus, as you've just mentioned, is the flattened part of the flower in which all the floral parts are born, whereas the pedicel is known as the stalk of the flower. Now, other parts of the flower include the bract, which is the growth at the bottom or the base of the flower. And a flower is said to be bracteate when a bract is present, and ebracteate when it is absent. Sepals are members of the outermost row of the floral parts and together form the calyx. Now, the calyx is generally green in color, and so are the sepals. The petals, on the other hand, occupy the next row of flowers and of the floral part and are scented and brightly colored, and together form the corolla. Stamens, that are the third inner row of the floral parts, are together called the androecium, which is the male reproductive part of the flower. And therefore, it can be divided into two parts. The stamen consists of the filament and the anther. And within the anther are the pollen grains. Now, carpels are the members of the next row of floral parts, which together form the gynoecium, which is the female reproductive part of the flower. And the gynoecium basically consists of three parts: the stigma, style, and ovary. And within the ovary are the ovules where the seed is born. In a flower, the stamens and the carpels are directly involved in the process of reproduction and therefore are known as the essential parts of a flower, whereas the sepals and petals are indirectly involved in reproduction and are known as the accessory parts. Now, while studying a flower, it is important to have a clear knowledge of the terminologies that describe the floral parts. And Darakshan, would you please start off?
Oh, sure, sir. Various terminologies representing different types of flowers are, number one, a complete flower. A flower is said to be a complete flower if all the four whorls are present on it. For example, like China rose. Incomplete flower. A flower is said to be an incomplete one if any of the four whorls is absent or missing. An example of that could be gourd. Unisexual flowers. These are the flowers which have only one reproductive organ, meaning either male or female, that is stamen or carpel. An example of that flower could be cucumber or gourd. Next is bisexual flower or hermaphrodite flower. These are the flowers which have both the reproductive organs, meaning male and female, that is both the stamens and carpels. If present in a flower, it is called bisexual or hermaphrodite flower. An example of that could be water lily or rose. Now, next is symmetrical flowers. Symmetrical flowers are also called actinomorphic flowers or regular flowers. These are the flowers which can be cut into two split halves by passing a vertical axis which has to pass through a center, meaning a flower which can be cut into two similar halves by a vertical axis which is passing through the center. This is what you call a regular flower or actinomorphic flower. An example of that could be mustard or poppy. As you can see in this diagram, that this is a mustard flower and it can be cut into two similar halves by different vertical axes, but each vertical axis is passing through the center of the flower. Next is zygomorphic flowers or non-symmetrical flowers. These are the flowers which can be split into two similar halves, but only across one vertical axis, which is passing through the center. As you can see over here, meaning this is a flower which can be split into two halves, but only across one line or across one vertical axis, which has to pass through center. An example of this flower could be pea or sesame. Now, next is asymmetrical flowers or irregular flowers. These are the flowers which can't be split into two halves or two similar halves by any vertical axis which is passing through the center of the flower. An example of that could be opuntia or canna. Polysepalous flowers. These are the flowers which have the sepals which are not united to each other or which are free from each other. An example of that flower could be radish and mustard. Now next is gamosepalous flower. These are the flowers which have the petals which are joined together from each other or which are linked together. An example of that flower could be China rose. Now, as you have seen that the sepals could be united or they could be free, and the terminologies used for them are polysepalous and gamosepalous. So is the case with the petals. Polypetalous flower is that flower in which the petals of that flowers, they are not linked together or they are not joined with each other. An example of that could be rose. So is the case with the gamopetalous flower, meaning gamopetalous flowers are those flowers in which the petals of that flower, they are linked together or they are joined together. An example of that flower could be thorn apple and ipomea. Now, the arrangement of sepals and the petals on a flower is called aestivation. Now, aestivation is also a very important character. So now let's go to our sir and ask him, would you please further explain what you mean by aestivation?
Yes, for sure. As you've just mentioned, the mode of arrangement of sepals and petals on a flower are called aestivation. They're arranged in a particular manner, and aestivation is then further divided into four different kinds: valvate, twisted, imbricate, and vexillary. And examples of those would be, if it's a valvate flower, it would be custard. If it's a twisted flower, then it would be China rose. Imbricate would be a sessile pine, and vexillary would be pea. Other terminologies related to the floral parts in general and the reproductive parts in particular are monodelphous flowers. And in monodelphous flowers, The filaments are united into one single bundle, but the anthers are still free. An example of that would be in the China rose. Diadelphous flowers, in which the filaments are united into two bundles, for example, the pea or beans. In polydelphous flowers, the filaments are united into more than two bundles, and an example of that would be silk cotton. Another term that you should be familiar with is placentation. Now, placentation is the term used to describe the arrangement of a placenta inside the ovary and is divided into six different types. Marginal, those found in beans and peas. Basal, as in the sunflower. Superficial, that's found in the water lily. Parietal, which is found in the mustard or poppy flower. Exile, which is found in the China rose or ladyfinger. And free central, which is found in the portulaca flower.
The number and arrangement of the floral parts, their cohesion, adhesion, sex, and so many other characters, they could be identified or easily studied by a formula that is known as floral formula. So now let's request, sir, to please explain this floral formula further.
Yes, most definitely. At least I shall try. Certain letters, symbols, and signs are used in the floral formula to illustrate the various parts of a flower. As shown here in this card, you can see that the letter capital K with an asterisk and a number in the brackets indicates the number of sepals in a calyx when the sepals are free. The capital K with just numbers in the bracket indicates gamosepalous. Capital C is the with a number is for polypetalous. A capital C with the numbers in brackets is for gamopetalous. A capital A is for the number of stamens when the stamens are free. A capital A with a number in the brackets is when the stamens are united. A capital G with a number when the carpels are free, that is known as epocarpus. And a capital G with a number in the brackets is when the carpels are united, which is known as syncarpus. Now, a capital G with a line on top of it indicates that the ovary is inferior. A capital G with a line underneath it indicates that the ovary is superior. Now, the letters BR indicate whether the flower is bracteate or not. If it's present, it means that the flower is bracteate. If it's not, that means it's ebracteate. This symbol indicates a unisexual male flower. This symbol indicates a unisexual female flower. This symbol indicates a bisexual or hermaphrodite flower. And this symbol indicates an actinomorphic flower, and this a zygomorphic flower. Now, the features, as well as the general arrangement and structure of a floral parts, are depicted with the help of a floral diagram. We shall ask Darakshan to please illustrate the floral diagram.
Oh, surely, sir. Now, various shape signs and formulas used for the floral diagrams or the floral parts are this one for sepal, this one for petals, this one for stamen, and this one for placentation. Now, as you can see in this card, this is how you place all these shape signs for different floral parts in a floral formula. How they are arranged, the whorl of sepals, the whorl of petals, the stamens, and the placentation of the ovary. Now, sir, is it possible to know all the character of a plant or of a flower just by knowing its floral formula or floral diagram?
Well, not exactly, but there is sufficient information in most cases in the floral diagram and floral formula to help show or illustrate the basic characteristics of a flower. Dear students, now you should try yourself to draw a floral diagram and write a floral formula and learn the various signs and symbols and letters associated with it, and compare your answers with the floral diagram and floral formula, which we shall provide a little later. So far, we have discussed the characteristics of different types of flowering plants in order to place them into a specific group or subgroup. Now, this study will help in identifying the various characteristics of the flower and of the flowering plant itself to position it into the correct taxonomic nomenclature for that particular flower. Now, the floral diagram and floral formula that has been given to us is of this flower. And as you can see from this floral diagram and floral formula, that this is a complete flower, it is an actinomorphic flower, it is a bisexual flower, it is bracteate, it has a bract, which is this, it has 5 sepals, which are gamma sepalous. It has 5 petals, which are polypetalous. It has 5 stamens, which are free but attached to the petals, as illustrated here. And it has an ovary, which is superior, has 2 carpels in it, is epipetalous, and the placentation is exile. With this, we come to the end of this program. We wish to thank you for your attention. Until we meet again, Daraksha and myself would like to say Khuda Hafiz and best wishes. Khuda Hafiz. Dear students, hello and assalamu alaikum. I am Ali Abbas Qazilbash and I welcome you to our program on meiosis, cell division, and plant reproduction. I am sure that you remember that we had explained in the previous program the process of cell division known as mitosis, which occurs in all somatic cells of living organisms. The resulting daughter cells of a mitotic division are identical to their parents and have the same number of chromosomes as their parent cells, and such cells are called diploid cells. Today we'll be discussing about the type of cell division which is known as meiosis. This type of cell division occurs only in the sex cells of living organisms, the gonadal cells. In this type of cell division, the resulting daughter cells have half the number of chromosomes of their parent cells, and such cells are called haploid cells. Biologists carefully studied the cells that developed into eggs and sperms, and they found that just before an egg matures and a sperm matures, the chromosomes numbers have halved. This process is called meiosis. Now, dear students, we can define this cell division, meiosis, in a very simple way. Meiosis is the process by which the diploid cell divides into four haploid cells. You should keep in mind that meiosis cell division is also called reduction division. Meiosis occurs in all animals and plants that reproduce sexually. It is of fundamental importance for the understanding of genetics and evolution. Now, meiosis cell division is a series of two divisions, that is meiosis one and meiosis two, which results in the formation of four haploid cells. Now, you should keep in mind that during cell division, a series of changes takes place. Therefore, for our own convenience, we have divided each series of meiosis cell division into four stages. And these four stages are prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. Now, we shall discuss each phase in detail. Now, meiosis one, prophase one, is a particularly long and complex phase. Based on what has been observed under the light microscope, each cytologist subdivided the prophase one stage into a further five stages: liptatine, zygotine, pacotine, diplotine, and diakinesis. Now, the liptatine stage is characterized by the start of chromosome condensation. The very long thread-like structures of chromosomes first start to appear and coil up to form thicker threads. These are clearly visible under the light microscope. At zygotine, these chromosomes now pair up into homologous chromosome pairs, forming bivalents. Now, homologous chromosomes are those pairs of chromosomes which carry the genes that code for the same characteristic feature. The pairing of the homologue chromosomes is known as synapsis, and the term homologue means identical. Now, dear students, you should keep in mind that after synapsis or pairing of the chromosomes, a unit known as bivalent is formed. Then the chromosomes replicate at this point, resulting in the formation of two pairs of sister chromosomes, which are now referred to as chromatids. Therefore, each bivalent has four chromatids. Now, the bivalent formation is of great genetic significance because it is between the non-sister chromatids of these bivalents that crossing over occurs. Now, let me explain to you what crossing over is. Now, crossing over is the physical exchange of the parts of the chromosomes between each other, resulting in genetic recombination, which accounts for the variations in the genotypic and phenotypic features of the offspring. Crossing over occurs across a bridge between the chromatids, which is called the chiasmata. The next stage during prophase one is the pacotene stage. Now, during this stage, the synapsis of the chromosomes is complete and the bivalents have become still shorter and thicker. At the diplotene stage, which follows the pacotene, the chromosomes become even more coiled, supercoiled, and highly condensed sister chromatids remain attached all along their lengths. However, during this stage, the homologous chromosomes of each bivalent begin to separate from each other, particularly near the centromere. Now, I hope you know that the centromere is the region of the chromosome that attaches to the nuclear spindle fibers during mitosis and meiosis. As a result of the partition or partial separation of the homologous chromosomes, bridges are formed called chiasmata, which are the cytological manifestations of crossing over. Hence, it's logical to assume that the crossing over occurs during this stage. The next stage of prophase one is diakinesis. During this stage, the nucleoli disappear, the number of chiasmata begin to decrease, and as the phase reaches its final stage, The homologous chromosomes are held together only at their ends. The nuclear membrane still surrounds the chromosomes, but gradually disintegrates by the end of this stage. It is now clear that a series of changes occur in prophase I, which are complex and important to ensure genetic viability and variation among the offspring. The next phase, metaphase I, is of short duration. During this phase, the bivalents attached to spindle microtubules or fibers by their kinetochores. Now, a kinetochore is a point within the centromere which joined to the spindle fibers. The kinetochore microtubules extend only from one side of the centromere, the side that will attach to the microtubule. Now, the bivalents during metaphase I are lined up in the metaphase plate, or on the equatorial plate. Now, dear students, you should note that at this stage, only chiasma hold the homologous chromosomes together. The next phase is anaphase I. During this phase, as you can see from this diagram, the association between the members of the bivalent is disrupted when the chiasma ceases to exist because crossing over is complete. Now, the chromosome number is reduced from the diploid to the haploid number, but the sister chromatids still remain attached to each other. At metaphase I, there are 4 chromosomes. But in anaphase I, you can see that there are 2 chromosomes and they're moving towards opposite poles. The last phase of meiosis I is telophase I. Now, during this phase, the nuclear envelope reforms, the nucleoli reappear. Also at this stage, there may or may not be cytokinesis and daughter cell formation. Now, at this stage, daughter cell nucleoli are haploid, as half the number of chromosomes present on each cell, as shown in this diagram. Here, one should note that following telophase, there's a short period of diminished cellular activity called interkinesis before meiosis II begins. Now, interkinesis is similar to the interphase stage during mitotic division, except that DNA replication does not occur since replication is unnecessary because the chromosomes have already duplicated. Now, meiosis II, dear students, which we shall be discussing here, is in fact very similar to mitosis cell division, in which each cell divides to produce 2 identical daughter cells. In this case, however, 4 identical daughter cells are produced. In this diagram, we can see that from one cell, which contains 2 chromosomes, 2 daughter cells are produced, each containing 2 chromosomes. Now, meiosis II has been also divided into 4 phases: prophase II, metaphase II, anaphase II, and telophase II. Now, during prophase II, the chromosomes are still duplicated, spindle formation begins, and fragmentation of the nuclear envelope takes place. During metaphase II, which follows prophase II, spindle formation is completed, duplicated chromatids are aligned at the equatorial plate, kinetochore microtubules of sister chromatids point towards opposite directions. And then during the next phase, which is anaphase II, the centromeres divide, the haploid sets of daughter chromosomes move towards opposite poles, and cytokinesis begins. Dear students, then enters the final stage of meiosis II, which is telophase II. Here, the spindle fibers dissolve, the spindles themselves dissolve, the nuclear envelopes are reformed, 4 daughter nucleoids are haploid and genetically different from their parents and from each other are formed. Cytokinesis results in the formation of the four daughter cells. Now, to summarize the events of meiosis, let me repeat the definition of meiosis, which has been explained. Now, meiosis is basically a special type of nuclear division, which reduces the diploid 2n number of chromosomes to the haploid n number of chromosomes. It takes place only in the sex cells of all living things, in other words, in those cells involved in sexual reproduction. The summary of the events of meiosis are shown in this table, where the details of various stages and divisions and progressive changes during the process of meiosis are highlighted. In the sense that during meiosis I, at the prophase stage, homologs of each composed of sister chromatids synapse forming a bivalent. Metaphase I, bivalents are at the equator. Anaphase I, the homologs separate and move to opposite poles. Telophase I, at each pole there is one homolog from each pair of homologous chromosomes. Then for meiosis II, in other words, during prophase II, duplicated chromosomes are present, one from each pair of homologous chromosomes. Then for metaphase II, duplicated chromosomes are again at the equator. Anaphase II, the centromeres divide and the daughter chromosomes move towards opposite poles. And finally, at telophase II, each pole there is a haploid number and one of each kind of chromosome, resulting in four daughter cells. Now, students, we come to the next section of this program, and that is reproduction in plants. We can define reproduction as the process by which new individuals of a species are formed and by which a species perpetuates through replication. Let us now discuss the process of reproduction in detail. You may already know that there are two major types of reproduction in plants: asexual or vegetative reproduction and sexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction, which involves mitosis cell division, only involves one parent instead of two, as in sexual reproduction, which involves meiosis. Now, therefore, one or more offspring, new plants are produced by only one parent through the process of mitosis. Now, plants may reproduce asexually by fragmentation, budding, binary fission, grafting, cutting, layering, and spore formation. All these processes employ mitosis as the method of cell division and produce identical offspring. Dear students, during sexual reproduction of plants, which is the next topic we shall discuss, the formation of new individuals of a species takes place by the fusion of two haploid gametes derived from male and female reproductive bodies. In this diagram, you can see the union of the male gamete, which is the pollen grain, and the female gamete, which is the egg or ovule of a flower. This process of union between male and female gametes is known as fertilization. With this diagram, the process of sexual reproduction in flowering plants is described. In this way, you will also have some idea about the life cycle of a flowering plant. In fact, the part of the flower involved in reproduction are the stamens and the pistils. And you may well know that the stamen is the male reproductive body and the pistils are the female reproductive body. To make it a little easy to understand, let us divide the process of sexual reproduction into megagametophyte development, in other words, the development of ovary, the development of the microgametophyte, the pollen grain, the process of double fertilization, and finally, seed formation. Now, during the development of the megagametophyte, we can see that one or more ovules are present in the ovary. And within an ovule, a megaspore mother cell undergoes meiosis to produce four haploid megaspores. Now, three of these megaspores disintegrate, leaving one functional megaspore, which then divides mitotically. The result is a megagametophyte or embryo sac, which typically consists of 8 haploid nuclei embedded in a mass of cytoplasm. The cytoplasm then differentiates unequally into cells, one of which will be an egg, which is smaller, while the other of which will be the larger endosperm cell, which has 2 nuclei called the polar nuclei. Now, description for the development of microgametophytes can be initiated with the anther, which has the pollen sacs, which consists of numerous microsporocytes, which are called microspore mother cells. Now, each microsporocyte, as you can see from here, undergoes meiosis to produce 4 haploid cells called microspores. When the microspores separate and are about to leave the anther, each one becomes a microgametophyte or pollen grain. At this point, the young microgametophyte contains 2 nuclei. One is the generative cell and the other is the tube cell. Now, pollination, which is the transfer of pollen grain from anther to stigma, occurs when the pollen is either wind-blown or carried by insects or birds or bats and deposited on the stigma of the same type of plant. Now, dear students, look at point number 4 on this diagram. It is a pollen grain with a pollen tube, which grows from the stigma down to the ovule through the style of the pistil. Before fertilization occurs, the generative nucleus divides into 2 sperms. This germinated pollen grain with its pollen tube and 2 sperms is the mature microgametophyte. Here you can see that the pollen tube discharges the sperms in such a way that one of them fuses with the egg, forming the zygote, and the other unites with the 2 polar nuclei, producing the 3N triploid endosperm nucleus. The endosperm nucleus divides to form the endosperm, which is the source of food and nutrients to the developing embryo or seed. Now, this fusion of sperm with the egg and polar nuclei to form the zygote and endosperm is called double fertilization. As a result of double fertilization, the ovary develops into the seed, which contains an embryo, and the endosperm is the food enclosed by the seed coat. The wall of the ovary, and sometimes its associated parts, develops into the fruit which surrounds the seeds. To conclude here, we can say that flowers produce male and female gametes, that is the micro and mega spores, which unite during the process of double fertilization to form seeds and fruits. With this, dear students, we've come to the end of this program. Till we meet again, Khuda Hafiz.